You see, in every job that must be done, there is an element of fun. You find the fun and snap, the job's a game.
Mary Poppins is one of the most loved fictional characters of all time.
Take a look!
And it took Walt Disney 2 decades to bring Australian author P.L. Travers' story about the English nanny from the page to the screen.
Because it was so magical at the time, it was so much fun to be in that film.
Or a spoonful of sugar helps the medicine go down.
Walt Disney himself cast Karen Dotrice as the young Jane Banks. And the then 8-year-old was awestruck by her on-screen nanny.
I've never known anybody so professional. She really didn't step out of character, which was so smart because she wanted we kids to respect Mary Poppins and not become attached to Julie, which was quite right.
The shepherd who is ailing, the milkmaid who is glum.
The movie marked Julie Andrews' screen debut. Walt cast Julie as the magical nanny after catching her performance on Broadway. And Dame Julie was only too happy to lend her singing expertise to her young co-star.
If you want this choice position...
I've been trained by somebody at the Royal Shakespeare Company how to sing this song, Perfect Nanny, so I went... If you want this choice position... Well, thank Christ, Julie had her very rare day off and she was standing there and I could see her jaw drop. Oh, my God.
That's not
recast.
How the song should be done.
Not a lot. No, not so much. And so, bless her socks, she said, OK, everybody, take 5. Actually, I think it's going to take, like, 45. And she took me aside and she said, you know, this song is about a little girl asking for a nanny and, you know, some help and some fun and some chuckles and stuff, and let's give it another go. So she taught me how to sing the song.
And never smell of barley water.
I would have got fired, probably, if it hadn't been for Julie having the day off.
American Dick Van Dyke's role as the Cockney chimney sweep Bert continues to be seen as major miscasting by many, though he was much loved by cast and crew.
He was just like his show, the Dick Van Dyke Show. He would fall over everything. He wouldn't see if there was something in front of him. He was always falling over and bruising himself and spilling things on his lovely costumes and stuff. I mean, that was fine when he was a chimney sweep.
Kicking the penguins.
Totally kicking the penguins. Penguin abuse all over the place, you can't imagine. Now, super fun guy. It was really hard, though, to try to keep a straight face because, you know, the camera would start rolling and we were all up, you know, and he got himself together, but we weren't as professional. But love him half to pieces. Best man on the planet, outside of my dad.
Now, by his own admission, his Cockney accent was an absolute shocker. Right.
Bert was so frightened.
No, don't take on so. Bert will take care of you.
With a jolly holiday with Mary.
If he's going to say it was terrible, it's okay to say that was a walking disaster. terrible. It was embarrassing. And it was embarrassing at the time. We were all going... Because we were all English, and it's like, what about a flight of this? In fact, and it was, yeah, that's a joke, right, Dick? You know, you're not going to carry on that way. But the Americans didn't know the difference, so they were fine with it. Whatever. They were paying the checks.
We love to laugh.
Movie special effects in the 1960s were in their infancy, and the Disney studios continued to push the technology boundaries, even if there were risks involved.
My parents, who up to that point hadn't let me get a pony in case I hurt myself, all of a sudden they're like, sure, yeah, Uncle Walt says it's fine. Go 40 feet up above the air on a merry-go-round horse with, you know, like a little mattress underneath. My very first day was makeup and wardrobe, and they said, OK, Karen, nice to meet you, bend over. And I thought, hello, Vicar, where's this going? You know, I'm not quite sure. And they said, OK, we're going to do a plaster cast of your ass. All of those scenes when you're either going up a banister inside of your costume is your bum, you know, in a plaster cast.
The plaster cast, they didn't burn your bum.
No, you didn't burn your bum. Plus, they could drag you up backwards, which was handy. And like for the tea party scene, you know, we were flipping around in the air with this cast thing on our bottoms. So it was terrific fun because you felt very safe. Didn't look safe, but it was safe. Oh,
supercalifragilisticexpialidocious. The secrets behind one of the movie's most iconic scenes was kept as a surprise from the young cast, so their reactions would be genuine.
The sequence where she's taking stuff out of the carpet bag, I don't remember seeing how that worked. To me, it looked like it was really going on. And that was the other thing, they really tried to keep wee kids engaged and not bored. Like in the supercalifragilistic scene, we're sitting on a fence, and that scene, because of the first time they were putting animated cartoons in with humans, so they didn't quite know how to do it, they had us sitting up there with toffee apples, and it was so cute, the props guy at the end of every day, it took like a week to film the sequence, would say, you know, all right, Karen, Matthew, what toffee apple flavours do you want tomorrow? So they were trying to keep us busy with giving us different ones, you know. Didn't like the lime one, though. Funny that.
God, it's nice to know you're appreciated.
Kerri-Anne comes from a family of prominent British stage, screen and television actors. So a career in showbiz was almost her destiny.
My dad's an actor, Roy Dotrice, and spent lots of time in Australia, actually, doing many, many shows over there. And
he was in Game of Thrones, too, at some point.
Yes, he was, naughty boy, but I wasn't allowed to watch it because at the time my kids were quite a lot younger and there's a lot of nudity in that show, so...
Shocking.
Very. And then my sister Michelle is an actress.
She was Betty.
Betty in Some Mothers Do Have Them, you're right.
With the wonderful Michael Crawford.
Oh, Michael, yeah.
It was Karen's godfather, the multi-award winning actor Charles Lawton, who cast her in one of his plays.
And they needed a little boy to be in the play. And my dad volunteered me, said, you know, put a wig on her, Karen can do anything like that. So my first job was sword fighting and stuff with my godfather, Charles Lawton.
It was during that production that Karen was spotted by a Disney scout and soon after arrived at the Disney studios in Burbank, California.
Is it very far?
Oh, we can't make it tonight. We'll have to stop over somewhere.
You, of course, starred in three fabulous Walt Disney movies.
Well, certainly two. One of them wasn't so fabulous.
Which was that?
Well, I don't know. I mean, have you seen the Gnomobile?
I have.
Yeah, you know what I mean then.
But I was very young. And yeah. You're easily pleased when you're very young.
But then you had a big nap, I'm taking it, because you saw it. I mean...
When you wish upon a star...
Kerri-Anne had a close and lifelong relationship with the man she called Uncle Walt.
What was the real Walt Disney like?
You're going to make me cry. I packed tissues just in case. I loved him. I mean, even to this day, all these years later, he can do this to me. He was so smashing. He treated me and my sisters like princesses. Not in an icky way, but I mean, just loving and caring and adorable. I mean, they redid Uncle Walt's office just recently at Disney Studios, and it's all preserved exactly the way it was in his day. And he has his diary there, and if you're not allowed to touch it, but if you ask them, they'll open it. And this pages where it just says, you know, lunch with Kerri-Anne Dotrice. It was just the two of us and an 8-9-year-old kid.
That crazy wild rumour that persists to this day that Walt Disney, your Uncle Walt, had been cryogenically frozen.
I hope you're right. Wouldn't that be great?
We're looking for our cousin. His name's Hanny.
Unlike other Disney child stars, Kerri-Anne never went off the rails and made a seamless transition to adult actor.
I was like 24 and I just made a film called The 39 Steps in England. It was very nice, they'd give me awards and stuff for that. And I said to my folks, can I go out to LA for a week to promote 39 Steps? They said, sure, you know. And after about a week, I thought, sod this for a game of soldiers, I don't want to do this anymore. I think I want to stop. So, didn't call my agent for like 2 years, just kind of popped off the log and disappeared and thought, I'm done. That's it.
Kerri-Anne remains part of the Disney family, and in 2004, she was honoured with the prestigious Disney Legend title. She shared the honour with her Mary Poppins on-screen brother, the late Matthew Garber.
Serious honour. We were both honoured, you know, the kids from Mary Poppins and from the other films we made. So it wasn't just me, it was the duet of us. I've got the statue, it's lovely.
You do.
Mickey Mouse with a wand.
Mary Poppins is the only Disney movie to be nominated for a Best Picture Oscar during Walt's lifetime. It lost out to My Fair Lady, but Julie Andrews took home the Best Actress statuette. For Kerri-Anne Dotrice, the experience making Mary Poppins really was...
supercalifragilisticexpialidocious.
I mean, look at Disneyland, look at the movies they turn out. Look at all the joy that that man has brought to us, unlike any
magic
other.
Magic to millions.
Yeah.
Billions, as a matter of fact.
Yeah.